The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GCR Progressive Internet Radio management, staff, or our affiliates.
Toto, I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, visionary talk radio on GCR Progressive Internet Radio. Fair rock in your world.
And welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, visionary talk radio on GCR Internet Radio. We have an awesome show for you tonight. We're talking about beliefs and esoteric stuff and apocryphal, discussion. And we have a wonderful guest on who's an author of a number of books, and it's Rodh De Sailor, and we're going to be bringing him on in a minute. I hope everybody had a wonderful Memorial Day. It's rough on the Jersey Shore. They're doing everything they can to bring the people back to the Jersey Shore. And down the camper, I was watching the news. It was kind of funny, because all the mayors from the local towns were on there saying, and we're ready. As you can see, the boardwalks are finished. And I kept thinking of the movie Jaws, where the mayor is saying, yes, a large walrus was captured. It maybe hurt a couple of swimmers. I mean, the only thing missing was the sign behind these people with a shark eating a swimmer. And they all... we're doing the same thing. They're saying, we're ready. We're ready. We've got it going. Everything is ready. You know, come down to the Jersey Shore. Today, the president was here with Governor Christie to give it the old, yes, they're ready. They've got the boardwalks ready. Of course, that's lovely. They have a lot of people. The boardwalks are ready, but half of Lawrence Harbor, half of Union Beach, half of Manilocan, those houses are still all gone. There's thousands and thousands of families who are still displaced. That, and I'm not talking about they don't have, it's not that the houses are in bad shape. The houses are gone. They're just where the areas the houses used to be, and there's nothing there. But the shore is ready. They've got the boardwalks back up, so everybody can come and play the games on the Jersey Shore. They're ready for you. So I hope everybody comes to the Jersey Shore and spends money, because I guess that's the priority right now. Again, I want to thank you, everybody, for listening tonight on the players, on the site. I've got a little bit of crazy butt news. A passenger aboard Alaska Airlines flight from Anchorage, Alaska to Portland, Oregon, tried to open an emergency exit during the flight. Passengers were reporting this to the Associated Press, who printed it. The suspect, Alexander Herrera, 23, of Arizona, made unusual statements that were starting to scare everybody, and then he attempted to open the door on the plane, and one of the other passengers put a chokehold on him, and they held the guy down and tied him up with his shoelaces until the plane landed. I think people are getting tired of this stuff, and he's lucky they didn't beat the living hell out of him. I'm sorry. You know, if you've got problems flying, don't fly. Anyway, this guy is being held for psychiatric help and everything else, so I just hope it was a matter of him being afraid of flying or something like that. Another crazy but news, and this is really weird. A North Carolina couple said they've traveled to Hawaii so that dolphins can assist the birth of their child. Heather Barrington, 27 years old, and Adam Barrington, 29. I saw their pictures. They look like throwbacks to Woodstock. Told the Charlotte Observer that a book called The Ancient Secret of the Flower of Life gave them a bright idea. And the couple flew to Hawaii in April to begin a month-long preparation to become part of a pod of dolphins. And when she gives birth in the water, they're hoping that the dolphins will do like they do with baby dolphins and bring the baby up to the air, and that this is supposed to be this whole big nature thing. I'm just hoping that they don't look at this squiggly little baby and say, oh, wow, look at that, it's food. I mean, I don't know. I don't know why anybody would want to do it like that. I mean, it's hard enough just having a baby, but, you know, having a pod of dolphins watch you, come on. You know, it's bad enough when you've got a half a dozen doctors, nurses, and your old man saying, I'm so proud of you, as your spread eagle on a table, but she's going to do it in front of a bunch of dolphins. Okay, whatever floats your boat, I don't know. Another thing in the news today is they're starting to become concerned about the consumption of Diet Coke. Evidently, Diet Coke is starting to give people the same results as crack. A woman that had been drinking Diet Coke so she didn't get fat ended up losing her teeth, and it's called Coke Mouth, and it is as abrasive Diet Coke on your teeth. She drank 2 liters of Diet Coke for the last 20 years, and now she has no teeth. Anybody who drinks a liter of that stuff is out of their tree. Diet Coke has a lot of chemicals in it that kind of trick your body into thinking, yes, it's safe, but it screws up your chemicals. None of that stuff is good for you. I mean, I drink Coke, but not 2 liters, not even a liter a day. You know, sooner or later, it's going to affect your health. And you know, I'm old, and I remember my mother way back in 1950 saying, don't drink too much of that stuff. It's not good for you. But evidently, people need scientists to tell you that this stuff isn't any good for you. So that's the crazy but news today. I just report this stuff, guys. Tonight, our guest, I'm over the moon, is Rodh De Sailor, and he is a thinking man. He's a very thinking man, and he's written a bunch of books about a kind of trek that his life of enlightenment has led him on. And I played the Moody Blues opening, Cold Hearted Orb That Rules the Night, Removes the Colors from Our Sight, Red is Green and Yellow, White, But We Decide Which is Right and Which is an Illusion. And that is actually written by William Shakespeare. And it seemed very appropriate, because if I'm getting the gist of the book, we are kind of being fed an illusion, and it's going to take work for people to turn around. Rodh De Sailor, welcome to my lair.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
You want to tell them the name of the book?
The book that you're referring to is called The Book of Apocryphal Truth. It has an acronym which stands for the BOAT, but that's basically what it is, and it's about my life experience from everything from God to spiritual healing to UFOs, remote viewing, creating your own destiny and things of that nature. I mean, things that I never once even gave a second thought to. I ended up being right in the middle of all of these things, and it changed my world.
This started when you read a book, another book, years ago, right?
It
kind of opened your eyes?
Yes, you're referring to a book I read that I give credit to by another author, David Icke, and I think that book really allowed me to wake up, because the things that I had I was slowly experiencing at that point in time, really did not come to the forefront, but I was having some experiences, and like most people, you tend to put them off. But one day, one fateful day, as I call it, I came across this book at a local bookstore, and I began to open this book up, and right there, I saw a lot of the things that were written about in his book that I could relate to. And then I began to see things that he wrote in his book that I had never considered before. And it just really, really brought about a whole change from what I was doing at that point in time and the way I looked at the world. And, I mean, it just changed my life. I mean, it's kind of incredible and hard to explain, but it really has made a big difference in my life.
The book was called Children of the Matrix, How an Interdimensional Race Has Controlled the World for Thousands of Years and Still Does. Let's talk about David Icke for a moment. He used to be a jockey?
Yes, he was. Some people may be familiar with David Icke. He was an ex-jockey in London. And began to, and an ex-athlete also over that way. I believe he played football, their version of football. And he ended up working on the radio, and how he really stated in his book that he became awakened was on a trip to Mexico, visiting one of the ruins down there, and it changed his life around. He began to see things a lot more differently than what we see them now. So that was pretty much what he said that happened to him. And this book really brought me about, and things began to happen in my life. And, you know, prior to that, I was really one of those type people that worked on Wall Street, making six figures and doing things of that nature, bringing companies public that with technologies and stuff of that nature. And I never thought about these things twice, not even twice, and until that fateful day, and it begins to, you know, my life changed. I just see things totally different now.
It's kind of, the publisher of the book, David Icke, claimed that the world is being controlled by unseen forces that have plagued and manipulated humanity for thousands of years. You know what it reminds me of? That movie called They Live. It was a ridiculous little movie with Roddy Piper, the wrestler, where they find out that there are aliens or extraterrestrials living with us, and that there's some kind of radio signal that keeps us from realizing they're here, and they're all like in our mayors and governors and everywhere, and they're really running the world, and we aren't aware of it. It kind of is like that, what he was kind of saying. How did it make sense to you, though?
Well, when I began to look into it, I agree with some of what he wrote in his book, but I depart from a lot based upon my experience only. It doesn't mean that David is wrong and that I'm right, but it's just my experience. And we all have an individual experience when we come into these things. But what I do see that I will give him some credit to is there are people here that are far more advanced in terms of evolution than we are. You may say that some of these people may come from someplace else, but then again, they may just come from here. Also, from areas that we don't really have on our radar screen. And that these people are more developed, and they are capable of doing things that we, as normal standing human beings, just can't do, or for one reason or another. But I will tell you this, that once you begin to become alert of these things and awaken yourself, you begin to gain some of these powers, not everything that they can do, but you do possess some things that you can do as a human being on your own. And that in and of itself convinced me that there's a lot more to being human than we were led to believe.
Yeah, the topics, you say right in the beginning of the book that you are not a member of any occult group. You don't have an agenda here for a group, right? You did this research strictly on your own?
I did. I invested pretty close to 20 years of research, maybe a little bit more altogether, and my own money, my own time, and I'm still not a member of any group or religious doctrine of anything of that nature. Although I believe in God, I can't adhere to any particular religion. And that's not to say that I don't believe in Christ, as some people have accused me before they read the book. I do believe that Jesus once walked the earth, and he did do some miraculous things. But I also believe that Jesus Christ was not the only one, that there were others, and that my experience has pointed that out, that I've run into people that had some incredible abilities. So, mm-hmm. You know, that's just my view of it, and I don't think anyone could do anything to change that view. But I'm just one person, and I'm trying to share with people what I have witnessed and the things that I can do. I mean, for a while there, just to give you an example, I went around healing people, and I had never done that before. Before, I thought it was just something that people were faking or doing these things, so I never charged anybody for my services. And I ended up having some miraculous events that occurred in terms of instantaneous healing of other people. And then I turned around and healed myself of something, of an ailment that I had, and I've been completely healthy ever since. So people could say what they would, but, you know, it still wouldn't change my mind because I know what I've experienced. And I believe that we as human beings are the ultimate observer of our own life experiences. So what I'm saying is that we are both the experiencer and the observer of our own individual life.
You're a philosopher. You describe yourself as a philosopher?
Yes, I have a PhD in metaphysics, which most American institutions look down upon. But I consider myself a philosopher in the terms of Pythagoras, as one who wants to learn. So my mission in life is to continue to learn. Learn more. I don't think we can ever know enough. So I believe that is my mission, is to seek knowledge and continue to grow.
Okay, I'm just going to press you a little bit here, and I'm not trying to be rude, but you have a PhD in metaphysics. Where
yes.
did you get mm-hmm. that from?
Sedona University.
Where?
Sedona University.
Okay, and what is that metaphysics when they teach you this?
Ministry, basically. It's it's along the same lines as separation of church and state, just like theology and so forth. But I only pursue that because I want to learn more. I want to know if they knew something that I didn't know, so I pursued that, but I had already begun to awake when I pursued that.
Mm-hmm. You say, what I came away with this is you are a proponent of meditation, and let's face it, meditation means sitting there and analyzing, whether you're talking to God in your head, whether you're talking to the Stay Puft, guy from Ghostbusters, whatever. Meditation is a way of getting a clear look at everything. It's looking at the problem and thinking about it. But you say that's the beginning of getting yourself in order, right?
Well, really, the way I view meditation is some of those things, but that's only an after effect. But what I view meditation as, a way to sit down and do nothing. To me, that's the whole part of meditation is really to do nothing. Allow your mind to rest itself, because the mind is always moving. You're either thinking about your past, you're thinking about the present, or you're thinking about the future. But what people fail to realize is that when the mind has time to rest, that means still itself, calm itself, then you can really see through a lot of things that you can't see through, because your mind is constantly moving. It is always in motion. So meditation, in its simplest form, allows you to just let the mind rest. And when you can let the mind rest, you can begin to see through all the things that we normally don't see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's kind of like shutting down the feed of static so you can sort through things. You do quote the Bible a lot in the book.
Yes, I do.
Seek first the kingdom of God, and all things will be added to you. And so I don't understand why people would think that you are not a believer in God. You don't believe that you're being given the ability to heal by God?
I do believe that God, and what you have to understand, what I consider God is within everybody and everything. So God does all the work, but we have to channel that energy of God within us to direct it towards what it is that we need to have done. So in that respect, that's why I give a lot of quotes, because the Bible to me should be understood metaphysically, and then you can apply that to today's life, because as you know, the Bible is both metaphorical, and there's very little bit of literal understanding of the Bible by most lay people that read the Bible. Most people, in my experience, I've been to some churches, and they're told to follow this passage, and then they'll jump from the New Testament all the way back to the Book of Laws and Deuteronomy and connect these things together, and they're really centuries, if not thousands of years apart. So I come at the Bible from a metaphysical standpoint of view, which allows me to understand most passages that I have read and memorized, a better understanding of it, and how I can apply that to today's, course of living.
Mm-hmm. See, I have healed, but I always ask God to do it. When I lay my hands on someone, it's me asking God to work through me, to use me. And He has said yes, and he has said no. You know, it is all God's will, you know. I never look at it as I'm the healer. God is the healer, and I'm just the one asking. Let me ask you, let's get back to and we're going to go to break in 5 minutes, but you think there are people in high-level positions all over the world that know more than they're sharing, and it's kind of like a hierarchy of information that they're keeping to themselves?
I believe so. That's my belief, yes. Mm-hmm.
Can you explain it?
Well, for instance, if we go back to the 9/11 situation, when that happened, a lot of conspiracy theorists believe that George Bush knew these things were going to happen before they happened. I say he didn't know, but he is a part of the chain, but he really didn't know. I mean, they kept him out of the loop. That's just and I'm not a George Bush supporter in no means, but I have to defend what I believe that he knew at that point in time. So there are obviously some people calling the shots from someplace else. I will tell you the other thing, from just looking at the evidence, how can they solve this case so quickly? I mean, when the plane came down, within you know, a day or 4 hours, they find passports that were completely not burned or anything of that nature. But yet, the buildings themselves were toast. I mean, so you have to look at that and say, well, look, there's just no way, because first of all, the passports that they found on the streets of New York had to have been in the plane at the time that the airplanes actually went into the buildings. So we would say there's no way they could escape the heat and all these things and land out there on the street for somebody to find these things. So the information was just coming in too fast. Okay, that is one thing. Another thing that led me to believe this is during 1997, when Princess Diana met her untimely death, she appeared to me in a vision, and I was not a fan of Diana. She appeared to me, and she spoke to me, giving me some information about her death. Now, I'm sitting back, and I'm saying, how is this possible? You know, and another situation that happened was in 2006, in the fall of 2006, Osama bin Laden appeared to me and told me he was dead. Now, I know that's a controversy when you consider that President Obama and his team, so-called, who hunted him down in 2011 or 2012 or something of that nature. But I was telling people way back in 2007 that the guy was no longer living because I saw him, he appeared to me. But how did his demise actually occur, I don't know. So, but that tells me, even with Obama in the office, somebody else is still calling the shots. You know, and people will say, well, how come George Bush didn't receive credit for this? And I can't answer that. I can only speculate on why. But I will tell you this, based upon the things that I've experienced and that I've been able to do in terms of someone that was not into all of these things, something is wrong. And it's not what we believe these things are. So any rational mind would sit back if they observe these things and notice the same thing, and they will reach a similar conclusion, maybe not exactly as mine, but they would say among themselves that something is wrong here with the entire story. I mean, and then when I look into the Bible itself, on one of the older versions of the King James Bible, and literally on page 3 from the beginning of the book, there's a page 3 in there that tells you who actually owns religion in this world, and that we are all subjects of these people. I won't say who they are, but I'm saying, is this a mistake or what? Is this a joke or what? But it's right here in the book. So something is wrong, and we're not being told the entire, you know, story of our, you know, evolution. We're just not being told, where did we really come from? How are we able to do some of these things? And people are beginning to experience things that they can't explain, but yet they always have a family member or a friend or someone to say, look, don't tell anybody this, or they'll think you're nuts. So once you get over that fear, as I have, then you begin to speak out, because it was totally against what I did and what I believed.
We have to go to break, and we're going to pick this up when we get back. The next song we're going to do is Moody Blues' Gemini Dream. And let me push that over. Okay. And we'll be right back. This is GCR, and we're talking about The Boat. So it's a book on Amazon, and I think you could get it at Barnes & Noble. We'll be right back.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
This is Mo inviting you to visit me at my lair. Mo Banshee's Lair Visionary Talk Radio airs every Tuesday night live on GCRInternetRadio.com. Tune in at 9 p.m. Eastern Time Zone.
Topics A to Z, Mo Banshee's Lair on GCR Internet Radio, and we're rocking your world.
Just try to stay out of my way. Just try. I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog, too.
And welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio, and we are talking to Rod De Sailor, who has written a book, The Boat, book of, a apocryphal mysteries and truths. And I was just asking him about the Illuminati. When people think there's a secret group in the background running things, most people yell out, "It's the Illuminati! You know, they're doing it all." And then, you know, Lady A from the from the chat, messaged me and spoke of Nostradamus and the Quatrains, that he could see the future. I'm not a huge conspiracy person. I think if you give me what has happened in the last few centuries is, as we've made it a lot easier for men to work with machines, and this has given them downtime, it gives man a lot more time to think and a lot more time to see, you know, can I bend that spoon by thinking? Can I change things by thought? And I think that's responsible for a lot of things. What do you think about the Illuminati?
Well, I think the Illuminati is it stands for the Enlightened One. And if you are enlightened, that means you're in possession of the truth. So when I hear the word Illuminati, I have good connotations of it, but others may differ. But I would say this here, Einstein was most likely an Illuminati, so was Newton, and they added quite a bit to society, technology. Now, this is not to say that there isn't some group out there, unknown to us, that mean harm overall to humanity. I mean, it's not defending that at all, but I believe that the core value of the Illuminati itself, to carry that name, is one of truth, people that are in possession of the truth. And I think just like history has been wrong about a lot of things, they're doing a terrible hatchet job on the Illuminati itself.
Mm-hmm. You see, I would look at Einstein and think, he was specifically, really, if he were born today, most people would think he had a bit of autism in him, because he focused on his science and on math, but the guy didn't bathe, he didn't change his clothes, I don't know how he had children, I really don't, but there's a story that a woman said, "Oh, that man smells," and he turned around and said, "Madam, I don't smell, I stink." he corrected her usage on that. See, I don't see people like Einstein actually getting involved with a group like the Illuminati, because that to me would make him part of a political club, and he was not anything like that. It was strictly science for him, and math, and that vision, and I think he would see that as a distraction, that all that nonsense in the background, you know. But that's just my opinion. So, who do you... Go ahead.
Oh, well, you know, your opinion is well-deserved. I mean, Einstein was all of those things. He was also a very poor student that really had the equivalent of a... He didn't attend high school, our equivalent of a high school, mm-hmm. by the way. He went straight from what we would call an elementary school to a university. And the whole time, he really was terrible at math. But we have to understand that he was given forewarnings and things of that nature. He knew when to leave Germany, for instance, and go aboard to Switzerland and eventually to this country and so forth. And he still ended up contributing a whole lot to society. And based upon that, he was an Illuminati because he became enlightened. And he mentioned once in one of his biographies that I read that the secret to E equals MC squared came to him in a dream. So he simply needed other scientists around the world, including those from Germany, to help conclude his, you know, assumptions about energy and matter and all of those things. And then we could look at Isaac Newton. They're just now beginning to let people know the truth about Newton. And Newton was none other than the Illuminati, mysticism and alchemy and all these things. So, and then you look at Nikola Tesla, who really invented the way we communicate today on cell phones. And the ability to use radio and television was all the invention of Nikola Tesla, who himself said, if you want to learn about the universe, you need to study energy, vibration, and frequency. That will teach you all you need to know about the universe. And there's one quote from Nikola Tesla, who also stated that if you want to learn more and become enlightened in life, talk to a higher source within yourself. So all these people didn't just come about these things. They were taught these things, as were people before them. And I can go on down the line. And even the American Edgar Cayce would state the same thing. So the Illuminati, in my opinion, has been given a bad job. People think that they are mostly criminals, and that's not to say that some of them are not. But overall, I believe that they've done more for this society than anybody we see in public today.
Yeah, I agree that there have been great minds, and they perhaps were not what society, you know, endeared themselves to. Einstein was a weirdo. Tesla was brilliant and all that, but he dedicated his life to science. And really, back in the day, mysticism and all that was simply another word for science. Back in the Dark Ages, somebody would mix a potion together and be called a mysticist, and really they were just figuring out chemicals with penicillin and different ways of helping mankind. And I call that evolution. I don't call that somebody in the background who's brilliant, that's kind of pulling strings like puppets. But that's kind of the way I got the feeling that you're trying to say there's somebody else out there pulling strings and we're just little puppets, no?
Well, it's not that we're just little puppets. We are indoctrinated into a system. It's how the system works, how they control us. They control our thoughts from infancy by programming our parents before we were even born, and programming their parents and so forth into a system. And that system is embedded into education all the way up. Look at it this way. The education system does a lot of good for society, but it is also a manufacturing outlet for corporations. And corporations have one god, and that's called profits, the almighty dollar. And that's not to say that the dollar is bad. I mean, I'm not anti-capitalist or anything of that nature, because I have received the benefits of capitalism. But if you look at it philosophically, you have to understand that there is something at play here. How is it that some people get a chance to work in a particular position at a high level at a corporation without education? And then you turn around and you see people with, people out here with masters of business associations, administration degrees, that can't even find a job nowadays. I mean, it's gotten to the point where college is not enough. I mean, there are people that need to have a four-year degree just to be a receptionist in most places nowadays. So it's really gotten to the point to where people have followed the program, but now the program is shifting on the people that entrusted these systems. Who's calling these shots? These things are not just happening. Something is at play here to make these things happen the way they are. And some of those people that are, their intentions are not good. And some, there are some good people. I mean, like, for instance, I think Bill Clinton and Hillary are good people, although some people would disagree with me. And that's not to say that they're totally innocent in any form and any manner. But I have seen a lot of good from these people. And I've seen a lot of bad from so-called black American civil rights leaders. I've seen them do, I witnessed quite a bit of bad things from some of these people. So it's not to say that they're all bad or all good, but, it's just up to the individual. But in and of itself, there is something, someone calling the shots. How they're doing this is totally speculation, but you have to know that there's something there.
When you talk about people like the Clintons and that, I always joke, but I'm deadly serious when I joke about this. I would not be president of this country for all the money or power in the world, because it's a job where you're going to have to make a call, and you're going to have to decide which is the least worst thing. In other words, they line up 10 bad things, and it's up to you to pick the best of the 10 ideas and hope that it'll have the least impact negatively on the people. And that's because there isn't always a good outcome for everything, you know? When Einstein became irate, he was told that Japan was very, very close to having an atomic weapon. That's why he went ahead and helped create the atomic bomb. And then when he found out that he'd been kind of hoodwinked, he was very upset. But the bottom line is, did the United States want a Japanese atomic bomb in the middle of Washington, D.C., or do you want to drop one in Hiroshima? It's a crapshoot. It's a balancing act, and it's a very hard thing to be president of the United States and have all that responsibility on you. And a lot of times they don't even have that responsibility. It's kind of just blamed on them. You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean. I mean, you can do some good, but still people that look for the bad is going to point that out. I mean, that's just mm-hmm. life. And it doesn't yeah. matter what choices you make, you're not going to satisfy everybody. And that's what any president that will run such a large country, and doesn't matter if it's here in America or somewhere else. But still, overall, you look at the presidents in and of themselves, they all have some elements in their family that is strictly criminal. I mean, this goes all the way back. And you got to say to yourself, now, how is it that, this come about, to where, like, for instance, Joe Kennedy was, he benefited from the legalization of alcohol, or prohibition, mm-hmm. as they call it. But before this,
he was
and
a
they knew this
was,
yes. And not only that, what role did he play in busting the mobs to take them out of business, so he can end up being the most, the largest beneficiary of that policy in the country. So,
right.
And we can look at Bill Clinton, his brother, we know was a drug dealer. That's just a fact. And then you can, I can point to what a friend of mine told me, and I won't give his name because he was in Homeland Security and the Navy in some capacity, and just told me they unloaded at one point in time, a ship down in Miami that they intercepted, and nothing on this ship was cocaine. And they thought when they got into port down in Miami, they would have news cameras out there showing the biggest bust in U.S. history. Instead, there were tractor trailers loading these things with civilians to places unknown. I mean, so, and there was never a mention of this in the press. So, you know, there's so much going on in this country. We just don't know whom to believe or you know, what story is right, what story is true. But know this, someone or something is calling the shots.
And you think it's somebody that, like an ancient society or possibly a non-human entities that are living among us?
Well, I have had some experience with that, and I do believe that, but I don't have any empirical evidence that would, you know, that I can bring before anybody and say, look, here it is. I mean, if that was the case, I probably wouldn't get a chance to talk to anybody. They'd probably eliminate me from point blank. But I will say this. I have run into people on several occasions that I confronted, and they were not from this planet. So that has happened on several occasions, and I confronted them because I picked up on it, and I was not afraid. So, and they went on and admitted to me. I have no proof that what they said was true, but based upon what we talked about, I knew there was some truth to what they were saying. So, I mean, there you have it. I mean, how can I say that this is true and this is not true? But that's just my experience.
Right. Okay. So you've been approached. Have you been asked to keep your mouth shut?
I was hacked
stop
once
writing?
Down in Florida.
How about that? Have you? Stop writing.
Well, no, I was hacked in Florida once. I had some information stored what I thought was in a very safe place, and I was hacked, and they left a little note and told me I know some things, but I'm not there all the way yet, and they destroyed my information. So they just wanted me to know that I was being watched. So I wasn't afraid of that, but I didn't think that I would be on anybody's radar. So at that point in time, I just thought to myself, I might as well come out, you know, because these people knew I was compelling. Go ahead.
Yeah, the best way to do it is when everybody knows the secret, it's not a secret anymore.
That's correct. I mean, so... You know, I looked at that event and I said, well, how did they know I was here in the first place? That means that someone on the local level pointed me out, or some case, you know, that is unbeknown to me. But anyway, they found me and they destroyed my information. So I had to start from scratch because I have research from years ago that I'm just beginning to put into books and stuff, and some revelations that maybe will shed some light onto things, but I caution people, it's not the whole truth, it's just versions of the truth.
I will say that I believe, and we're going to go to break again in like 5-6 minutes, I do believe that we are being fed a lot of misinformation, so that we don't focus on things that we're not wanted to focus on. I think the best way to get people off of something is by starting to feed the news media a bunch of misinformation. I almost believe that, like UFOs, because you mention them in your book, UFOs. I believe our country is trying to create a ship that would be like Lost in Space, where an entire complement of people could go up and leave from Earth on that ship without having to go up to a space station and switch over. I believe that that's what they're doing, but having people look and say, oh, it's a spaceship, it's an extraterrestrial, gets everybody's mind off of the government and what they're actually doing. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, my thought is that with the experience I've had on seeing a UFO of unknown origins, is what I call them, up close, and that this thing didn't make a sound. It just stood in the air without any propulsions or anything, silently. Then I would say if the government does have something of that nature, they've done a great job. It's about time they need to come out with that and put an end to, I mean, they could virtually destroy any aircraft, any enemy aircraft out there, if they are in possession of this technology. And I don't know that that's the case, and I don't know that these UFOs that I've witnessed are from somewhere else. I never did see any people in these things, because I wasn't that close, but I was close enough to identify it. You know, being former military, I just don't know. But those are my experience. That's what I saw, and that's what I'll stick to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I live near Lakehurst Experimental, and you know, seeing very odd, aircraft is a way of life, you know, and so I think that if they're looking to send large complements of people up into space, it behooves them to build something that's going to be able to take off of the Earth's gravity, leave and go out, and without playing transfer and beam me up, Scotty, and all that, because really that's a very expensive way to do it. But I think that maybe because people are chasing their tails looking for E.T., most people aren't even thinking of it. And I keep going back to that movie 2012 where they build the arcs, and you know, nobody knows that they've been building these arcs for the flood that's going to take over the Earth, you know, and that makes a lot more sense to me, you know, with filling the news and the internet with all these sightings and that kind of thing. That makes more sense to me than E.T. coming here just to watch us or play mind games with us or try to control us, because they're not doing a very good job of it.
I agree, but I will tell you this, that, you know, flight, for instance, why is it that, you know, Leonardo da Vinci thought of flight and actually drew the plans for what turned out to be, in today's time, a helicopter way back then. So, you know, there are so many things we can point to, like the battery, for instance, is not a new modern-day technology. They had batteries in Egypt back in the ancient times. So the Ark of the Covenant was probably some sort of technology, but we marked that off and said, well, it comes from God. It was given to the Hebrews by God and so forth. But how do we know that? We know that wasn't some type of non-human device that was given to particular people to, you know, protect them and do so forth. And then the other thing I would say is, if there are UFOs, you know, eventually they'll make themselves known.
We're going to go to break, and this is very interesting because, like I say, you know, I just don't get, you know, all the conspiracy around it, because I just think that if you give somebody enough time to think, they're going to come up with some stupid idea. That's mankind, you know, since Cain and Abel, you know, we've done a bang up job of screwing each other. And that's just the way they are, but that's me. We're going to go to break, and I picked Isn't Life Strange by Moody Blues, and we'll be right
to Jurassic Park.
Well, hello there. This is Stan inviting you to listen to Jurassic Park, where we dig up the old bones of rock and roll, 50s, 60s, 70s, and beyond. And then carefully rebury them. Thursday nights, 8 Eastern, on GCR.
welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GCR, and our guest tonight, Rodh De Sailor. We're talking about his book, The Boat, and we're talking about apocryphal mysteries, and we were just talking about, you in your book, you say you just want people to wake up. Can you explain that?
Well, I want people to understand that life sometimes, in my opinion, more mysterious than truth. And because we have this mystery about us, that no one absolutely knows the truth, and that includes the versions we've been given historically in our educational systems, and the people that we trust to give us information over the course of our life so far, that no one really knows it all, and that we should be more open to things that are outside the box as a possibility. Not that you have to accept these things, but just be open and listen to these things, because eventually you're going to run across something that you experience yourself that is unexplainable to you.
Do you feel, because I'm going to share a little story which I've shared to my listeners before, but my first husband was in Vietnam, and the in-laws, or outlaws, depending on how you want to look at it, came to the house one day, and they said, there's scissors out in the, they have one of these RV drivable campers, the scissors are out there, could you go get them? And I'm looking at them saying, well, I have scissors right here, what do you need those for? And they said, no, go get the ones out of the the camper. So I go out there, I'm looking all over, I don't see scissors. I come back in, everybody's looking at me like I've got lobsters crawling out of my ears, and I said there were no scissors there. And then they looked at me and said, we left something for you in the camper. And I trudge back out, look, and there's my husband sitting there right on the table. And he looked at me, he said, you looked all over, you looked through me as if I wasn't here. I says, well, I wasn't looking for you. Do you feel, after looking at this book of yours, do you think we've been groomed to wear blinders so we don't look past a certain veil?
Well, I will say this, that the subconscious level of mind is very powerful, and it can be programmable. Unbeknown to the people or to the person that is being programmed. And it is that ability that really projects our reality. So we can see things that we don't see on the surface, but the subconscious mind sees these things. And since that's the most dominant aspect of our life, then yes, that is very possible.
Yeah, you know, because I do see that when people go out on an investigation with us or something, they have been taught to look for the obvious, and they almost look through things and don't see things that are there, because I guess they've kind of been taught, just like a baby. There's nobody there. There's no invisible man. There's no friend. You don't have an invisible friend. We teach children to learn to filter spirits out, don't we?
We absolutely do. Well, let me put it this way. Our educational indoctrination system does that. And all those programs are aimed at the subconscious level of thought. And that's where it becomes more powerful. So we don't notice that there are disembodied spirits of people who once lived in the flesh all around us all the time and so forth. We just don't see them because we are trained to see other things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's like a dog. People say, well, my dog is looking up and there's nobody there. And I try to explain to them, that's because you can't teach a dog not to see a spirit. Or you can't teach a dog, you know, all they understand is blah, 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 Daisy, you know, or blah, 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 Fido. So if you're standing there saying, Daisy, quit looking at the air. There's nothing there. That dog is looking at something, but they don't understand what you're saying, and you can't prove. But a child learns that certain things are going to get them yelled at, and certain things are going to become a problem for them. What has your, because I don't have a problem with God and spirits. God creates spirits. You're either ready to go with him or you're not. And if you're not ready to go, he's not a bully. He leaves you here till you are ready to go with them. How do you correlate spirits and with your philosophy that something else is going on and there's a someone else pulling strings? What's your philosophy with spirits?
Well, I can only tell you about my experience, and then based upon my experience, what I have concluded. And, you know, rightly or wrongly, first of all, I have seen what we call spirits or ghosts, disembodied spirits or what have you, as a child. My great-grandmother, when she passed, I was about 3 or 4 at the time, and I had no concept of what death was. And even though I was at the funeral, watched as we lowered her body, her casket into the earth, she was still with me when we got back to the house several months ongoing as if she had never died or anything, because I had no concept of this. We were able to communicate back and forth each and every day, each and every night, rather. So I eventually outgrew that, and, you know, maybe because of being indoctrinated more and more in Houston, that at some point this communication cut off. But then I had a near-death experience once, personally, myself, out on a golf course, and I ended up floating over my body, and I could see and hear everything that was going around. I could see the young people that I was with, that I was teaching how to play the game, how they panicked, and this one little kid was standing over me while everyone else was running back to the clubhouse to get help, 911 and so forth, because we didn't have a phone out there. And there I was laying down and, you know, just totally out of it to whatever means. And as the emergency personnel approached, and if I could see all of this stuff, and during that time, I looked in on my wife, I looked in on our daughter, and I just made a decision that I wasn't ready to go somehow. And once I made that decision, my body began to come back to life, seemingly a limb at a time. I know my eyes were very heavy at that point in time. I couldn't open my eyes, and I couldn't move my limbs. But once I made the decision to come back, it was like I couldn't see anything that was happening anymore because I had been sucked somehow back into my body. And then my body began to slowly come back to life. And then I gained vision and thought. And the paramedics, they looked at me, you know, I mean, because they had virtually put a sheet over my head. So they looked at me. And they couldn't believe I got up. And then they come over to check me out again, and they say, do you want us to take you to the hospital? I said, no, I'm fine. I don't need to go anywhere. I mean, you guys can't make me go anywhere. I don't need to go anywhere. And I walked to the clubhouse, sat down, had something cold to drink, jumped in my car, and drove home. Didn't tell my wife about it for almost a year because she would have panicked. So, you know, that's one of my personal experiences. And then I witnessed an uncle of mine that died for 2006. He died for, no, it was 2005. He died for 4 days, came back to life. And I later found out that was his third near-death experience. But that was the longest he had been away from his body. And he's still alive today. And if you were to speak to him, he would tell you he knows what death is. It's not what we think it is. You know, so he has no fear of death. Neither do I.
No, I don't. I'm not afraid to die. I just it, getting dead is the problem. Sometimes that really sucks. But once you're dead, then it's all gravy after that. You talk about the spirits and all. How does that tie in with these beings that have the information and are kind of pulling our strings, and why do you think, they're aware of all of this, or do you think this doesn't, reflect on them? They're not interested in this part of life. Do you think they're just trying to control us, the living, or do you think they have some control over spirits too?
I don't think that they have control over individual spirits because we all have a thing called free will. But this is why they use systems such as the indoctrination system, which includes a host of things, education whatsoever, including the job industry, to control our thoughts, control the lifestyle that we live, and so forth. I mean, but I do believe that there are people with ancient knowledge that knows how to go back and forth between what I experienced as an out-of-body experience. They can do this almost maybe seemingly at will. I don't know if that's true, but I believe that there are people that have this power because if we could do this from time to time, there has to be someone just like playing a sport that is much better at it than we are. I mean, it just has to be. I mean, we call these abilities in the physical world modal properties. Well, I would say if we look at that people that have this ability have a better understanding of how to do this than we do overall, and they can do it at will. And yes, they can take advantage of information that they perceive during that time because there's no limit to what they can do once they're in that realm of existence. I call it a pure existence. You can call it a ghost, or you can call it whatever. I believe a ghost and disembodied spirit is all the same thing. It's spirit, it's the mind, it's your true essence once you leave the body. So, to me, all those things are the same.
Okay, so when we were talking during the break, you said that these are, because there's a question. They're asking who are these beings that you think are in charge or who are kind of manipulating us. Do you think it's possible that over the centuries they've been trying to condition us not to use natural things like psychic powers, out-of-body experiences? Do you feel these were all things that we used to have and it's kind of being bred out of us?
I believe that these are things that we have in us now, but we have lost touch with it in this incarnation of our life, okay, overall. But yes, if you can keep people away from discovering these other energies that are within themselves, then you can control them. You can't control their free will, so basically you can control the information they receive. And by controlling the information, you can, you're programming their subconscious level. And once you do that is a matter of control. I mean, and it can be more specific than that because if you look at it from a physical standpoint, as a former soldier in the army, when I was young, the first thing they do when you go in as a soldier is they break you down, they destroy your identity,
Right.
and then they reprogram you. And that's every army in the world. I mean, at one point in time, all I thought about as a soldier was going out there, giving up my body and dying in a war for my country. That's all I thought about. I thought of nothing else. I mean, it was 24/7. Those were my thoughts. I even wrote my own epitaph back then, what I wanted on my grave once I went and died in battle. So if they had that much control over me, imagine what you can do with a society if you control the amount of information they receive.
Okay, so are you comfortable in saying who you feel is actually trying to manipulate us?
I would say that I really can't point to it, but I would say that we can start with the royal family. And I know that's a hot button, but you can probably start with them.
Okay, with who again?
With the royal family.
The royal family. That also plays into what's his name, David Icke's thing that he, excuse me, he feels that the Queen Mother is a part of this. And I don't want to use conspiracy because we don't really understand if you subscribe to this. You don't, I'm not trying to say that she's in a conspiracy, but she is aware of what's going on, right? That's what he says, David Icke.
Well, I will point it out this. First of all, they have any army in the world available to them. And yet, and this is beyond the borders of Great Britain now, they have every army in the world that they can order into combat. I mean, period. So, I mean, when you look at it, including our army, okay, so where does all that power come from? I mean, and you look at that King James the First, who has his name printed on many Bibles, actually plagiarized the Geneva version of the Bible and made it his own, and actually had a statement in the book saying that we own you. So many people don't read these articles that are in the beginning of the Bible. They go straight to passages here and there, but they never read the first part of the book to where they will see these things. Of course, you need a King James version, and you probably need a much older version now because as people began to understand these things, they're looking at these books and finding these statements in the book at the beginning that I own you, I own humanity. And the other thing is, I don't think David Icke pointed this out in his book, but I point this out in my book. They have no last name. They've been assigned a last name so that people will stop the suspicion and all the, the talk that has been going around. But what they did was they assigned the last name to the area, geographically where they are from. Like if they're from Wales, they would be the Prince of Wales. Or if they're from York, they'd be the Prince of York. But they have no official last name, just the first name. The only people still living in this world without an official last name. How is that possible?
I thought they had they were from the House of Wallace or something like that.
That's, notice, it says House of. I mean, come on, that's not a last name.
Wallace would be the last name. I mean, my family on one side is Robertson, the son of Robert, so it's the House of Robert, from Scotland. I mean, the Queen, if you look at feudalism and the way kings, if you look at that, even in other countries, Patel is a big Indian name, Patel, and it's actually from the region they're from, the region of Patel. They just all use that as their last name. That's not an unusual thing for places.
Yeah, but look at the royal family. They are all special. They are treated like royalty wherever they go. It doesn't matter which one. They go to a country, they get the red carpet wherever they go. They are never put in harm's way, except for when they kill one of their own. And I really won't get into that, but but they're never placed in harm's way. I mean, for instance, Harry, good guy, I would assume, joined the service and served in Afghanistan, but he was so far back. from all the fighting that, you know, chance of him getting hurt was nil. So, I mean, but, you know, it's good for the record, but not just him. You look at George Bush, for instance, and everybody knows this. He got into the National Guard so he can avoid Vietnam, and that's a fact. I don't care what anybody say. He used contact for that to get that position because they had a four-year waiting list to join the Alabama National Guard. And why did he become a member of the Alabama National Guard when he was not a resident of Alabama? I mean, so all these things you have to ask. I mean, any sane person would look at that and say, well, look, there's something wrong here. And then his brother, Neil, who we barely hear anything of, during his divorce, his wife even ratted on him, his former wife, and said, this guy sits on the board of corporations and have no qualifications. I mean, come on.
Right. Well,
do you think
money has privileges? Money has privileges. And money has privileges, and if you've got enough money, you can be anything you want, you know, and that's kind of how politicians do it. I mean, what is it John Fogerty wrote, you know, I ain't no senator's son, you know, unfortunate son, you know.
Yeah, but we can go farther than that, too. Yeah, we can go a little bit deeper. George Bush, the grandfather. Okay, everyone knows he was the financier for Hitler. So just one of them, of course. And then two, you know, we can point to IBM, Roe and the Holocaust and so forth, Mercedes, Benz, and all these companies had a role in the Holocaust. But given the fact that our presidency is ruled by a family that is deeply, you know, they say generationally, blood-wise, related to the royal family of Great Britain, ought to tell you something.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think their big surprise was Obama then. I don't think they knew they were related to him. Well, Jack the Ripper, you're going back to Queen Victoria. They thought her son or grandson might be Jack the Ripper, and there are still rumors that, you know, he sired an illegitimate child, and the word was given to get rid of the prostitutes until they could find this illegitimate child, you know. So, I mean, money has its privilege, and that has never changed. And you know, they become kings and queens and stuff like that back in the day. And, I mean, look at the popes. Have you seen that show, The Borgias? With Jeremy Irons? I mean, they make the mafia look like nice guys. Really,
yes,
Rodrigo Borgia got into, became Pope by killing the guy everybody wanted to be Pope. And that's just humanity. And I think that's opportunity knocking and somebody saying, you know what? We could be the Pope. You know, we could be the royal family if we knock this person off or that person off. I do think that there are bad people who sit there and say, okay, let's take advantage of this and wipe somebody out. But on the other hand, to say that there's a certain group of people or like a certain, I don't know, invisible group of people that are orchestrating it, that's a huge leap, isn't it?
Well, it is, and that's what makes it sound so incredible. But let me say this. What exploits of their own that allowed them to gain this power over the world in the first place? And we have to ask that. How did they come about this knowledge of control, you know, about the subconscious level of mind? I mean, 200-300 years before scientists began to study this phenomena on their own. And it's been within the last 100 years, thanks to Germany, by the way, that psychology itself, which is the study of the mind, became a science. And people really don't understand that even though psychology is a science, there's still so much they don't know about the hidden levels of the mind.
We have to go to break. Again, it's 10:31, and we have to go to break. So when we come back, we only have 30 minutes left to talk about this, and it is fascinating. And we didn't even touch half. We didn't touch anything about healing, telepathy. I do want to talk about prophetic dreams with you. And see where that falls in this whole big thing. We'll be right back with our guest, Rodh De Sailor, and his book is called The Book of Apocryphal Truth, Mystery of the Kingdom, and we're going to ask him when he comes back exactly what that means. And we'll be right back. This is...
Okay.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio, and our guest, Rodh De Sailor. We're, hang on, everybody. It keeps wanting to start that song. We're talking about his book, The Boat, and it's a really good read. It's got a lot in there, and you can find it on Amazon. Rod says he's just trying to get people to open their minds and start experiencing more and trying to think more out of the box and ask themselves, why exactly is everything happening the way it is? Is someone else somehow making us choose these things? Are we being manipulated somehow? And one of the things is meditation, responsibilities of the subjective mind. He walks you through, you kind of walk them through how to start thinking about what's going on, right?
I do, and how they can ascertain this information for themselves. In other words, sometimes the best way to get people to see things is to experience it. And that's basically what the book does. It outlines what experiences I've had, and there's been many, and I'm willing to go on the record with all of those. But I want people to know that it's not just me, this guy. We all have this ability as human beings. And the key to these abilities really is to go within yourself. But you hear that so many times, and people are lost in translation of what that means. That means really to sit back and do nothing. Close your eyes and do nothing. And that's basically the true art of meditation.
I don't know if you know the story of the guy. He was a little man in Florida. He built the coral castle, and they said that he always said he was waiting for his sweet 16, and they don't understand how he moved large objects and large boulders. He didn't have like machinery to move these things yet. When you go there, the doors open and pivot without any hardware, and he moved huge blocks. One of the things you say in here, the subjective mind is able to manipulate physical objects kinetically, size notwithstanding. So have you been able to use your mind to move something?
I have. In addition to that, oh, by the way, the guy you were talking about, his name was Edwin, and he was
right.
From Europe, yes. But I have had that experience, and I wish I could do it any time at will, but I'm unable to, but in a time of need, it has served me well.
Mm-hmm. What about prophetic dreams?
Well, prophetic dreams, we all have this ability. I've done it, and I put some foresights in the book. The only problem with these prophetic dreams comes in the matter of interpreting the dream itself. And once we begin to have more experience at interpreting the dream, to know when a dream is literal and when a dream is symbolic, then we can better understand the message that is within the dream. And that's where our problems come. But we all have this ability, And I wrote in the book a few prophecies that have happened and some that have yet to happen. The other problem we have with these, prophesizing is basically timing, because the subconscious mind doesn't understand one thing, and that's time. Time and space has no reference to the subconscious level of mind.
You see, I had something happen to me in 2009. I had a dream that I was walking along a sidewalk. And you know how in the old towns you have the black slate that they lay down and use those black slate stones as sidewalk, instead of the concrete. And I'm walking mm-hmm. along the road, and there's three in line. And the first one, the guy lifts it like a coffin, and there is my mother, and it's her body, and she gets out, and she's walking like a robot, and she's kind of going la la la, like that. And I'm like, Mom, you don't want people to see you like this. Get back in your box, Then this man walks over to the second one that's right behind her, and they're all laid out like three cars in a line. And he lifts the next one, and my sister comes out. And I'm saying, Jenny, you got to get back in the box. You can't be walking around like this. You're dead, and you don't look so hot, And then he goes to lift the next one. I said, you lift that next one, I'm going to put you in it. And I woke up. And I was like, what did that all mean to me? Obviously, there were three of these stones in succession. About 7 hours later, we were taking a ride down to our camper, and we were in a bad car accident. I was the first car. There was a second car behind me, and the third one is the one that hit us. And I think wow. The dream was trying to warn me that I was going to have an accident. It was really bad, and I had a concussion. The baby had a concussion. I mean, it was really, really bad. And but that was what I think the dream was trying to tell me, warn me about. And that, I that call may that be a true. Prophetic dream. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I would call that a prophetic dream. I would call that a prophetic dream also. Again, as I pointed out, we tend to misunderstand the symbols of the dream. If we can interpret the symbols literally to what it means to us in this reality, then we can better understand the dream. Sometimes, though, we experience a dream that's literal. And a literal dream is you will see everything as it is. Right now, you would know exactly. You would see what people are wearing. You would see what people are driving. You would see the entire event before it occurs. And so when you enter this in the waking state, you know exactly what's about to happen next. And those type of dreams, you can take advantage of it. But when you don't understand the dream, you can't take advantage of it, because, as it unfolds and you play it back and you say, well, this is probably what that means. Well, if we begin to write these things down, we can learn from it as time goes on to interpret the dreams much better than what we perceive them right now.
Do you, because you're talking, there's so much to talk about in this book, how consciousness, once you achieve this consciousness and start to bring out and explore these venues and try to bring, look and see what's out there that we've been conditioned not to see anymore. You said how consciousness ages your body. Do you think deliberately they're trying to stifle us so we don't wake up and actually see what's going on?
Absolutely. Well, not only is the secret to controlling the human race is in the subconscious level of mind, there's probably, based upon experience, one mind that we all share, but we share individual aspects of this. You can say, well, this one mind is God or higher intelligence. It doesn't matter to me because the name is not that important. But what really matters is that we are all interconnected somehow at the subconscious level of thought, and that we are unaware that we are connected to each other at that level. So basically, if you begin to program one person, you begin to program a whole host of other people that are unaware of this at the same time. And until we use what is called our free will to begin to bring things up to the conscious surface level, where we would be aware in this reality, do we begin to awaken and take control. And some of us, as I did, we begin to program our own subconscious level of mind to understand ourselves that much better, to where we can control our life. So, yes.
So is people like Galileo, Da Vinci, all of these guys, the church kind of stifled them and tried to shut them down. Do you think the church is being manipulated by whomever these hierarchy, whether they are extraterrestrials or people here on Earth, this like group of beings, do you think the church is being manipulated also?
I think there is some manipulation at the higher echelons of the church. There has always been. Keep in mind that they were really given life as we know it at the Council of Nicaea. So that was a political event as well as a religious event. But people don't see it that way, but it really was. You know, they chose what would go in this Bible, and they chose what would stay out of this Bible, which is, we call collectively the apocryphal text. And that name is what is on my book. It's called the Book of Apocryphal Truth. That means the forbidden things that they don't want us to know. And the Mystery of the Kingdom subtitle on my book is referring to your mind, the subconscious level of your mind, as well as the conscious level of your mind, how they interact with each other. But it is the subconscious level of mind that holds all the power. So, yes, there are people at the higher echelon of the church that have been aware of this. But, you know, in today's time, the church is beginning to splinter up. There are people in the church that are more awakened, and their voices are just beginning to be heard. And some of these people you will see excommunicated. They will go out and start their own church and so forth and so forth, because they become disenfranchised with the version of the truth when they are beginning to experience these things themselves. And then there are those that are trying to change the church from within. So, but only time will tell which side will gain more control and so forth. But I believe that light is what we're all after. That means truth is going to eventually stand itself out above all the, you know, the channels of lies that have been told historically and things of that nature. And it might be a generation from now, maybe not. Hopefully, in my time, I'll get to witness that.
Okay, so you think that we're at a point now where it's being talked about enough that people are actually starting to reach out and try to see what's really going on, and do you think we're going to have like a war here? Do you see a war of some kind with the disinformation or trying to hold control with, because a lot of people think, and Lady A in the chat room just messaged me and said, I think we're actually part of an extraterrestrial zoo. You know, we're kind of down here as a zoo, and they're just, you know, they bring the kitties here and say, here, look at the weirdo earthlings, you know, and that kind of thing. The same way we go to zoos and show our children the animals. Do you think we're headed for like a reformation or a war? Do you see any conflict where, as people try to go and start experiencing more and going back to that natural ability, that they're going to put their foot down and try to stomp it?
That's what I foresee. Yeah. Some people, I believe one day, and this is in my book, and I don't know when, but it's been a recurring literal vision for some time now, that one day we're going to look up and they're going to be everywhere. The sky is going to be filled with what we identify as UFOs landing and taking off and open parking lots and fields and things of that nature. It's just going to be to the point to where denying these things. And at that point,
you're breaking up.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I believe. Can you hear me?
Yeah,
you're kind of
breaking up. You're going in and out. I'm here, but you're going in and out like we're losing your cell phone or something.
Okay, how about now?
Okay, you're good.
Okay. I believe that I'm just going to backtrack in case people missed it. But I believe that one day we're going to wake up and people are going to see these things that we call UFOs all over the skies, landing in open parking lots and fields and things of that nature. And at that point in time, your belief or disbelief in UFOs will be a moot point at that point. There's no one that can tell you that these things do not exist. That's not to say what these things are, that they come from some other dimension or anything of that nature. But at that moment in time, we're all going to know. We're all going to know. I have seen this vision time and time again, and I believe it's going to happen in my time. I don't know when, but I know the vision gets more pronounced each time I see it. And it's the same thing. And it's not as if I believe in UFOs or disbelieve in UFOs, because when you become open to the truth, you see the information and you try to interpret the information as you see it the best way you can.
Mm-hmm. Well, this has been fascinating. The book, again, is The Boat. You want to tell them where they can find it?
Well, actually, you can find it at Barnes & Noble, Amazon.com, and all over the world, electronic bookstores, and the paperback format as well.
And again, it's Mysteries of the Kingdom, and it's talking about God, UFOs, psychic powers, mysticism, out-of-body experiences, remote viewing, energy healing, telepathy, something I can't read that I jotted down, spiritual awakening, enlightenment, precognition, all kinds of stuff, manifestations. I mean, there's so much in this book, and yet it still touches on what most of us consider a conspiracy, that there is someone pulling strings and trying to run everything, trying to limit the knowledge we have, and they seem to be muddying the water, as it were, keeping us chasing our tails and fighting with each other, so we're not really watching what's going on. We're not seeing the real picture because we're so busy at each other. And this book, I think, is an attempt to help people start to focus, if I'm understanding it. Is that kind of what you're trying to do?
That's what I'm trying to do, get people to open up and see the truth.
Okay. And I want to thank you so much for coming on, and I'll post it tonight on the recorder, and when it's up, I'll put it on your Facebook so you could see it, and then you can record it off of that. Thank you so much for coming back on, and I hope you'll come back again sometime.
Thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Okay, all you have to do is hang up. We have one more song before we leave tonight. And the reason I chose this song was because I saw a special Down the Camper with Janice Ian. And she was always a favorite of mine, a folk singer. And she sang my autobiography, and I just thought it was as cute as a button. I've heard it years and years ago and completely forgot about it. And I thought after this kind of deep, you know, talking and that, maybe we would try to listen to something that's a little bit fun. And so what I'm going to do is play this. And I hope everybody enjoyed the show tonight. Next week, let's see. I gotta look. I gotta bring it up. Next week, we're gonna have two guests. Erin Rambeau. She's got a vampire series books, and Allison Walkley, who's got Vatu, Woman in the Peace Corps. Two authors coming on with really interesting books. We're going to talk about vampires and the lore in literature, why Erin is writing a series, I guess, a group of stories about them. And this other young lady is coming on, so I think you're going to really enjoy that. That's on the 4th. And on the 11th, we're going to have the great-granddaughter of the unsinkable Molly Brown to talk about her famous ancestor. And then on the 18th, Captain Retired David Brown is coming back. We're going to talk about his grandfather's experience in the Civil War. We got a lot of stuff going on in June, and I hope everybody had a good Memorial Day. I hope you all enjoy Janice Ian. Visiting me at my lair. You can always contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for visiting, and God bless you and yours.
One fateful day, as I call it, I came across this book at a local bookstore, and I began to open this book up, and right there, I saw a lot of the things that were written about in his book that I could relate to. And then I began to see things that he wrote in his book that I had never considered before. And it just really, really brought about a whole change from what I was doing at that point in time and the way I looked at the world. And I mean, it just changed my life. I mean, it's kind of incredible and hard to explain, but it really has made a big difference in my life.
The book was called Children of the Matrix: How an Interdimensional Race Has Controlled the World for Thousands of Years and Still Does. Let's talk about David Icke for a moment. He used to be a jockey?
Yes, he was. Some people may be familiar with David Icke. He was an ex-jockey in London. And he began to, and an ex-athlete also over that way. I believe he played football, their version of football. And he ended up working on the radio, and how he really stated in his book that he became awakened was on a trip to Mexico, visiting one of the ruins down there, and it changed his life around. He began to see things a lot more differently than what we see them now. So that was pretty much what he said that happened to him in his book. Really brought me about, and things began to happen in my life. And, you know, prior to that, I was really one of those type people that worked on Wall Street, making six figures and doing things of that nature, bringing companies public that with technologies and stuff of that nature. And I never thought about these things twice, not even twice, and until that fateful day, and it begins to, you know, my life changed. I just see things so.
The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GCR Progressive Internet Radio management, staff, or our affiliates.
Toto, I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, visionary talk radio on GCR Progressive Internet Radio. Fear rocking your world.
And welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, visionary talk radio on GCR Internet Radio. We have an awesome show for you tonight. We're talking about beliefs and esoteric stuff and apocryphal, you know, discussion. And we have a wonderful guest on who's an author of a number of books, and it's Rod De Sailor, and we're going to be bringing him on in a minute. I hope everybody had a wonderful Memorial Day. You know, it's rough on the Jersey Shore. They're doing everything they can to bring the people back to the Jersey Shore. And down the camper, I was watching the news. It was kind of funny, because all the mayors from the local towns were on there saying, and we're ready. As you can see, the boardwalks are finished. And I kept thinking of the movie Jaws, where the mayor is saying, yes, a large walrus was captured. It maybe hurt a couple of swimmers. I mean, the only thing missing was the sign behind these people with a shark eating a swimmer. And they all were doing the same thing. They're saying, we're ready. We're ready. We've got it going. Everything is ready. You know, come down to the Jersey Shore. Today, the president was here with Governor Christie to give it the old, yes, they're ready. They've got the boardwalks ready. Of course, that's lovely. They have a lot of people. The boardwalks are ready, but half of Lawrence Harbor, half of Union's the crazy but news today. I just report this stuff, guys. Tonight, our guest, I'm over the moon, is Rod De Sailor, and he is a thinking man. He's a very thinking man, and he's written a bunch of books about a kind of trek that his life of enlightenment has led him on. And I played the Moody Blues opening, Cold-Hearted Orb That Rules the Night, Removes the Colors from Our Sight, Red is Green and Yellow, White, But We Decide Which is Right and Which is an Illusion. And that is actually written by William Shakespeare. And it seemed very appropriate, because if I'm getting the gist of the book, we are kind of being fed an illusion, and it's going to take work for people to turn around. Rod De Sailor, welcome to my lair.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
You want to tell them the name of the book?
The book that you're referring to is called The Book of Apocryphal Truth. It has an acronym which stands for the BOAT, but that's basically what it is, and it's about my life experience from everything from God to spiritual healing to UFOs, remote viewing, creating your own destiny and things of that nature. I mean, things that I never once even gave a second thought to. I ended up being right in the middle of all these things, and it changed my world.
This started when you read a book, another book, years ago, right?
It kind of opened your eyes? Yes, you're referring to a book I read that I give credit to by another author, David Icke. And I think that book really allowed me to wake up, because the things that I was slowly experiencing at that point in time really did not come to the forefront, but I was having some experiences, and like most people, you tend to put them off. But one day,
the ancient secret of the flower of life gave them a bright idea, and the couple flew to Hawaii in April to begin a month-long preparation to become part of a pod of dolphins. And when she gives birth in the water, they're hoping that the dolphins will do like they do with baby dolphins and bring the baby up to the air, and that this is supposed to be this whole big nature thing. I'm just hoping that they don't look at this squiggly little baby and say, oh, wow, look at that, it's food. I mean, I don't know. I don't know why anybody would want to do it like that. I mean, it's hard enough just having a baby, but, you know, having a pod of dolphins watch you, come on. You know, it's bad enough when you've got a half a dozen doctors, nurses, and your old man saying, I'm so proud of you, as your spread eagle on a table, but she's going to do it in front of a bunch of dolphins. Okay, whatever, float your boat, I don't know. Another thing in the news today is they're starting to become concerned about the consumption of Diet Coke. Evidently, Diet Coke is starting to give people the same results as crack. A woman that had been drinking Diet Coke so she didn't get fat ended up losing her teeth, and it's called Coke Mouth. And it is as abrasive Diet Coke on your teeth. She drank 2 liters of Diet Coke for the last 20 years, and now she has no teeth. Anybody who drinks a liter of that stuff is out of their tree. Diet Coke has a lot of chemicals in it that kind of trick your body into thinking, yes, it's safe, but it screws up your chemicals. None of that stuff is good for you. I mean, I drink Coke, but not 2 liters, not even a liter a day. You know, sooner or later, it's going to affect your health. And you know, I'm old, and I remember my mother way back in 1950 saying, don't drink too much of that stuff. It's not good for you. But evidently, people need scientists to tell you that this stuff isn't any good for you. So that beach, half a Manilocan, those houses are still all gone. There's thousands and thousands of families who are still displaced. And I'm not talking about they don't have... It's not that the houses are in bad shape. The houses are gone. They're just where the areas the houses used to be, and there's nothing there. But the shore is ready. They've got the boardwalks back up, so everybody can come and play the games on the Jersey Shore. They're ready for you. So I hope everybody comes to the Jersey Shore and spends money, because I guess that's the priority right now. Again, I want to thank you, everybody, for listening tonight on the players, on the site. I've got a little bit of crazy but news. A passenger aboard Alaska Airlines flight from Anchorage, Alaska to Portland, Oregon, tried to open an emergency exit during the flight. Passengers were reporting this to the Associated Press, who printed it. The suspect, Alexander Herrera, 23, of Arizona, made unusual statements that were starting to scare everybody, and then he attempted to open the door on the plane, and one of the other passengers put a chokehold on him, and they held the guy down and tied him up with his shoelaces until the plane landed. I think people are getting tired of this stuff, and he's lucky they didn't beat the living hell out of him. I'm sorry. You know, if you've got problems flying, don't fly. Anyway, this guy is being held for psychiatric help and everything else, so I just hope it was a matter of him being afraid of flying or something like that. Another crazy but news, and this is really weird. A North Carolina couple said They've traveled to Hawaii so that dolphins can assist the birth of their child. Heather Barrington, 27 years old, and Adam Barrington, 29. I saw their pictures. They look like throwbacks to Woodstock. Told the Charlotte Observer that a book called